Please let your eyes close softly. And notice how, just with the closing of the eyes, there is a natural stilling, a settling, a sense of your mind or attention being in the same location as your body. So let your attention sink into your body. Let your body fill your attention. One of the ways that we do this is to begin by feeling the contact of our rear on the cushion or the chair, feeling those sensations, pressure, the heaviness. Tingling, hardness, and gently moving to the touch of our hands, touch of our lips, hovering in the area of the lips until that felt experience registers in your awareness. The soft touch of the eyes. And sensing the felt experience of the whole body. Field of sensations that gives the sense of wholeness. Feeling the life. Vibration, the pulsing, sensing characteristics of the sitting body, shape, the form. Feel the gentle stillness. Notice the fading of any strain or tension. A feeling of letting go, letting be completely as is. And if you are feeling and knowing the experience of the sitting body sitting, you know that you are here. Body is always here. You know that you are now. Body is always now. So you know that the past has gone, future is just an idea, and you are in touch with the living present, which is so vital, so different from past and future, which are mental. So we never want to be separated from this living reality. One of the ways of staying connected is to keep our mind in our body, and our body in our mind. We continue that process of settling into the living present by feeling within our body the gentle movements that we make when we breathe. We feel the gentle expansion or contraction of the whole body. The rise, fall of the chest or the belly. Or we feel the air as it breezes past our nostrils, our upper lip. Breath by breath, we settle in to the life of the living present. And when our mind drifts into fantasy, drifts into time, at whatever point we become aware of it, we appreciate the fact that we are now aware, awake, and in behalf of remaining awake and aware, we anchor our attention once again in our bodies. The Buddha suggested that there's one thing that leads to a calm abiding, to focus, to the sure heart's release. One thing, O monks, O yogis, what is that one thing? It is mindfulness directed to the body. So notice what happens when you keep directing your mind to your body. Notice without trying to create it, but notice how it is calmed. Notice how our mind settles. And with that anchor of attention in the body and the body breath, we then try to graciously receive all the sense experiences. We graciously receive sounds, pleasant and unpleasant. We graciously receive moods, pleasant and unpleasant. And we graciously receive the whole range of thoughts and images, whether they are pleasant or unpleasant. But we remain still, anchored to our body, anchored to the living present. Everything happens here. There is no other life but this vital present. Everything else is imaginary. So don't miss it. Relax. Relish. Just this breath. Just this body. Just this moment. Your whole life has come to this moment. Don't search for anything but this. Soft mind, but alert. Gentle attention, yet precise. Intimately feeling the life of the body and the body breath. Happy to be sitting with all of you tonight. I'm making up as I go. It's just some reflections I had as I was sitting tonight. I was appreciating the fact that we're here, that we're sitting together, and I always think of what in the Hindu tradition is considered the sacred power of people coming together for the purpose of awakening or opening to truth, the way things are, and that there's a power in that. And I felt the field of a shared intention in our sitting together, and I do each week, and I so appreciate that. And of course, that reflection, that appreciation, didn't stop there. I started reflecting on the group in general, and you could say that I had a little bout of what we call papancha, or proliferation, a little elaboration on my initial sense experience called a thought. So I wasn't simply being mindful of thinking, treating each thought equally. Tonight I was following the thread, but my original intention was to see what would come up that I could possibly share tonight. And my next reflection was on the fact that when I started my practice of insight meditation back in the 1970s, I moved to San Francisco in 1982 after having done several three-month practice periods where I was in silence, but there were really no sitting groups. There were no regular sitting groups in San Francisco. There was no place that somebody could save up their practice for and go to that group for the week. There was no place where you could even center your practice around the weekly sitting group, as far as I'm aware of. There were some intermittent groups, and I visited a few when I came to town, but there wasn't anything established. The way that people practiced was to go on retreat, was to do it in a very consistent way over many days. And because of the continuity of mindfulness and the continuity of intention to awaken, many people in the course of their practice experienced some change in their heart, some clarifying of their mind, some easing of their stress, and a shift in identity. As I've talked a lot about on Tuesday night, a shift of identity from living out of that narrative that plays through our mind, that version of ourselves that's often filled with lack, from living out of that endless looking and searching for happiness, to be able to relate to that as the mind that's craving, or as the mind that wants something that it doesn't have, and to step out of that stream of distress and to even treat the distress itself as the manure of practice, as the cause of awakening, even the difficulties be turned into that which makes our heart open, our mind clear. So many people in those days, in the late 70s and early 80s, who got into practice, they came to it through that kind of continuity of practice. And if they had the passion to follow through with the effect of their retreats, they would move on to other retreats. And not always move on to other retreats, but something would take root where the practice of awakening, the practice of mindfulness, the practice of meditation would become, as I saw it happen for many people, it became the hub around which they lived their life. Everything was seen through that lens of using it in service of awakening. So there was nothing that one could experience in the course of one's day-to-day life that was outside of practice, outside of what we call meditation practice. Now, we're in a brave new world right now, though. Right now, there are still a smattering of people. There are still more people meditating. But there are fewer percentage-wise who are giving themselves wholeheartedly to this process, for that person, the meditation and the awakening is the hub around which they live their life. I'm not sure how many in this room for whom that's true, and I don't know. It'd be interesting to take a survey for how many of you is, you don't have to say, I'll just reflect on it for a moment. For how many of you is meditation and awakening the hub around which you live your life? Appreciate you putting your hand up. Well, an interesting thing, why I said that it is a brave new world, is during these last, I've been leading this group now for, I'm just completing my 31st year at the end of this year. And when I started, like I said, there were not too many groups, and mostly as the groups unfolded, they've been led by people who were able to, for either because of their passion or their resources or whatever, were able to give themselves, their lives over to this awakening process and experience some of the fruits that the Buddha talked about 2700 years ago. And today, there are still those people who are doing that. But there is also, simultaneously, what has arisen in this world is the teasing out of this comprehensive path of awakening called the Noble Eightfold Path, or fulfilling or realizing the Four Noble Truths. There has been teased out of this one element, the central navigator on the Noble Eightfold Path, called mindfulness. It has become the word du jour. It has become the practice du jour. It has become the force that, if you looked it up on the internet, if you did a search on mindfulness, you'd get something like 19 million different places that it shows up. It is everywhere. It's on the cover of Time magazine. It's everywhere. And it is primarily being used to enhance people's experience of their life, enhance people's experience of their work, of their relationships, of everything that one does in one's life. And its applications are absolutely limitless. But in most cases, mindfulness is not taught, and this is not a criticism so much, it's just a fact. It is not taught as part of a comprehensive path of awakening. It's not taught with the understanding that this, if it becomes the hub around which you live your life, can liberate your heart from confusion. It can give you the deepest, most unshakable sense of peace and freedom and clarity and all the noble qualities that human beings can express. It has enormous potential. And somehow, there is a danger that can be lost in the shuffle. Lost in translation. Why is this so significant? Now you may think, how wonderful, how extraordinarily wonderful that this beautiful tool is finding its way into schools, into businesses. Corporate America has adopted it like it's one of their own. And within big corporations, there are programs there. Google has Search Inside Yourself, where many people, including meditation teachers who are trained in Search Inside Yourself, are going to all corners of the world. One of my colleagues is going to Senegal next month. He's going to Senegal in Africa to do Search Inside Yourself mindfulness training for people who are on the front line of in war zones, and people, activists and caregivers, all in Africa. And so it's fantastic that all these amazing applications. But what's actually happening, and this goes back into our conversation of Dana. What's happening is there are so many opportunities to teach mindfulness, and so much so many resources available to support those who teach mindfulness, that many of the people who have put Dharma at the center of their lives, who have made awakening the hub around which they live their life, are not because of their wish to do this, but because of the opportunities, are choosing to forego the potential of their service to really support other people's awakening to the full breadth and depth of the Dharma. They're foregoing that to be able to make a living. Because the Dharma has always survived, those who offer the Dharma have always offered it freely. It's a beautiful thing. They've offered it freely because, first, the teachings are considered priceless. You can't put a price on them. It's not so that they're accessible to everyone, regardless of their resources. And three, as Linda spoke so beautifully, because of the liberating, the joy-inducing, the happy-making effect of practicing generosity. So the teachings were always offered in the spirit of generosity, in the spirit of kagga, but then a gift of the teachings, dana. And those who receive teachings as their practice of dana, of kagga, and the practice of giving gift, the gift of dana, have given people the opportunity to train their heart in that joy-inducing quality of generosity by inviting people to provide for the requisites of those who have offered the teachings. So the teachers give, the yogis receive, and the yogis give, and the teacher receives. And this cycle of giving and receiving, this interdependent, mutually dependent relationship, not just a transaction, but a relationship, has allowed the wheel of the teachings to roll for 2,600 years. But for most of the 2,600 years, those who have been offering teachings have been monastics. They have been part of a monastic system where those who offer support both the monastery and not the individual monks or nuns, but they support the monastery. And the monastics always live in a certain close proximity to the lay community. And so this very tightly woven relationship has been allowed the monasteries and the monks and nuns to flourish, as well as the lay community. Now, this particular model was so beautiful and so touched the hearts of the people who first came, who went to Asia and practiced and then brought the teachings back to the West. They were so touched by it that they wanted to carry on that model of giving and receiving, teachings continuing to be offered freely, as they are here in this room every week now for all these years. Only one problem with it. Those who offer the teachings these days are mostly lay people. Mostly lay people who are householders, who have the same needs, insurance and schools and medical insurance, everything, and housing. And clearly in the Bay Area, for example, the cost of housing has gone stratospheric. And so those people who would otherwise, especially the new teachers, now I've been living this way for so many years, and I have established relationships with people and communities all over the world that I have an ongoing relationship, that relationship of giving and receiving that has to a certain degree supported me. Unfortunately, this dana model, this model of offering the teachings freely, has made it that I have to teach probably 10 times more than I should. No, maybe that's actually an exaggeration. Maybe 4 times more than I should, in order for me to do the best job and to both care for myself and care for others. However, I've been very well supported. The people coming along today in this brave new world, they can't make it. They cannot make it on this beautiful offering of giving and receiving, unless people start to reconsider what the requisites are of the people who offer teachings, unless there's a real consideration, a much more careful consideration, that to begin to think that dana isn't just about something being offered cheap, but dana being something that you want to offer with that feeling of kagga, with that feeling of generosity, because you value so much wanting to support those whose life, whose practice is the hub around which they do live and do and work and do everything. That you really want to support those people so that they can give themselves over to a life of supporting people who want to develop meditation practices, not just a mindfulness practice. And they are starting to fade. So this is not meant to induce fear in your minds that there won't be any Dharma teachers, but there won't be any Dharma teachers. It's not meant to induce fear. It's meant to give you, it's meant to offer you some truth about the way it is. And it's, as Krishnamurti said, it's the truth that liberates, not our effort to be free. So it's something about naming really what we're up, what we're not up against, but what the situation is. And I think it would be a great shame if the teachings were not offered as that comprehensive, that view of a comprehensive possibility of liberation. That what you thought of when you thought of meditation is something that you just do on a Tuesday night. Or mindfulness is just something that helps you in this way or that way. So I was thinking tonight, you know, I can think in terms of this hub around which you live your life. Everybody has a different relationship to meditation and a meditation practice. So I don't ask very often, you know, what's your relationship to your meditation practice? Do you have one? Where does it fit in your life? Is it something you save for Tuesday night? Is it something that is the hub around which you do everything in your life? And I say this partly as an encouragement to look at your life and how you're living it. A few weeks ago, I don't know how many of you were here because it changes all the time, but I eulogized a beautiful guy who was a part of our Sangha, Javier Torres, who I had the great good fortune of giving a eulogy at his actual memorial. And the more I thought about Javier, I called him in his memorial. I said, Javier was somebody who, I don't usually say these kinds of sentences, but I said, he was a meditative success story. He actually brought a sense of urgency to his practice. Now, it was partly fueled because he had had a lot of struggles in his life, but he brought a sense of urgency. He practiced I like to think of, and he did it in daily life. He was a dentist. He was a hard worker. He was a family person, took care of his relatives, but he was on fire. And I like to think of one of my teachers said, practice like your hair is on fire, or practice without regard for body or life. There's a way that he brought that kind of urgency to his practice. It was clearly his mindfulness practice was geared toward liberating his heart from the tension that he carried so prominently. And he succeeded. He would often on Tuesday nights come and report how he was experiencing his mind. And slowly, I started to just, my jaw would drop as it was so clear that he was no longer relating to his anxiety and his different mental states from those states. He was relating to them. There was an element of his mind that had been unstuck from being bound up in the torments of his mind. And there was something, when I was reflecting on him tonight, there was something in that urgency that he carried. Something in the importance of doing it now. And you know, in the Tibetan tradition, before people even practice, what they study for, sometimes for years before they even sit, they study what are called the four reminders, the four mind-changing reflections, or otherwise known as the four mind changes. The first one is reflecting on the preciousness of this human life and the opportunities that you have since you've been born. The opportunity to either feed the demons or feed the best in us. As I read at the end of last Tuesday, you carry all the ingredients to turn your life into a nightmare. Don't mix them, he says. Hafez, carry all the ingredients to turn your existence into joy. Mix them. So this encouragement to appreciate that it is very precious, the conditions that you've been born into now, where there are teachings, there are teachers, there are opportunities. You have, at least at this point, the conditions where you can have enough safety to meet like this, where you can't in large swaths of the world, it is unsafe to meet like this. You have the conditions of enough good health, you have consciousness, you have some clarity, and to take advantage of this, appreciate it, and make something of your life. And of course, in the four reminders, the suggestion is you use this precious human birth to awaken. Don't squander it. And the second, just if you're wavering on that, the second reflection to give you that sense of urgency is that you will die. As Jennifer Wellwood says, this is her call to urgency. She says, "My friends, let's grow up. Let's stop pretending we don't know the deal here. Or if we truly haven't noticed, let's wake up and notice. Look, everything that can be lost will be lost. It's simple. How could we have missed it for so long? Let's grieve our losses fully, like ripe human beings. But please, let's not act so shocked by them. Let's not act so betrayed as though life had broken her secret promise to us. Impermanence is life's only promise to us, and she keeps it with ruthless impeccability. To a child, she seems cruel, but she's only wild, and her compassion, exquisitely precise, brilliantly penetrating, luminous with truth, she strips away the unreal to show us the real. This is the true ride. Let's give ourselves to it. Let's stop making deals for a safe passage. There isn't one anyway, and the cost is too high. We're not children anymore. The true human adult gives everything for what cannot be lost. Let's dance the wild dance of no hope." So she's saying, wake up to the fact that everything will be lost, that impermanence is life's only promise to us. And that's the second mind-changing reflection. The third one is that while you're here, you haven't lost what you will lose. And while you're here, every action that you take with your thoughts, your words, your deeds, everything that you do, say, or think plants a seed, has a result, has a fruit. And that hopefully that you will appreciate that your actions are not just lost in a vacuum. They ripple in all directions. And to then dedicate, to take that as a positive, that you can, if you want to understand what your past is, you can see it by experiencing how you feel right now. But if you want to understand your future, look at what seeds you plant. Look at your present actions and plant those seeds that lead to more happiness and well-being and peace and love and caring. And do it, and with a sense of urgency. And then finally, if you're not convinced, you don't have enough urgency, reflect on what happens if you're oblivious in this world. You think that life, you fall into misperception. You think what is impermanent can be permanent. You think what is reliable or what is unreliable is reliable. You think what is so personal, you think what is really so not personal, you take everything so personal. And life, the fourth mind-changing reflection is life has difficulties and defects. It's not so easy. Don't fight with that fact. Learn how to live in harmony with things the way they are. Otherwise, your whole life is a running from truth. And the more we run from truth, the more our mind falls into craving, into lust. And the more lust and the more craving, the more search elsewhere for our well-being, the more tension, the more bound up, the more tormented we are. I was, before I came in tonight, in this vein, I was reading about an odd sutra from the Buddha, from the what's called the Anguttara Nikaya, the sutra called the numbered sutras of the Buddha. And there was one that was, if I can find it, it was all about the Buddha's relationship to sleep. And there was somebody who passed by the Buddha. If I can find it, I'll read it. Oh, here it is. I found it. So the Buddha, somebody passed by the Buddha and said, and was curious, because he probably was thinking about his own sleep, and asked the Buddha, he said, Blessed One, did the Blessed One sleep well? He says, yes, Prince, I slept well. Among those in the world who always sleep well, I am one. But Lord, the winter nights are cold, and this is a week of frost. Hard is the ground, trampled by hoofs of cattle. Thin is the spread of leaves. Sparse are the leaves on the trees. Thin are the tawny monk's robes, and cold blows the wind. Yet the Blessed One says that he has slept well, and that he is one of those in the world who always sleeps well. Now, Prince, shall I put a question to you about this, and you may reply as you think fit. What do you think of this, Prince? Suppose there's a householder or a householder's son living in a house with a gabled roof, plastered inside and out, protected against the wind, with fastened door bolts and windows closed. And there is a couch in the house, covered with a long fleeced black woolen rug, with a bedspread of white wool, a coverlet decorated with flowers, spread over with an exquisite antelope skin, having a canopy overhead and scarlet cushions at both ends. Also a lamp is burning there, and his four wives, so it's a little dated, and his four wives attend on him pleasantly. What do you think, Prince? Would that person sleep well or not? What is your opinion about this? He will surely sleep well, Lord. He will be one of those in the world who sleeps well. What do you think, Prince? Might there not arise in that householder or householder's son vexations of body or mind caused by lust, hatred, or delusion, which torment him so that he would sleep badly? That may well be so, Lord. Now, Prince, the lust, hatred, delusion, greed, hatred, and delusion, by which that householder is tormented and which cause him to sleep badly, have been abandoned by the Tathagata. The Tathagata is the Buddha. Tathagata is one who knows the suchness of being, knows the liberation of the heart. Cut off at the, so these have been abandoned by the Tathagata, cut off at the root, made barren like palm tree stumps, obliterated so that they are no more subject to arise in the future. Therefore, Prince, I have slept well. So the Buddha has realized this cessation, the falling away, the uprooting of this hungry ghost, this being that lives in us with little mouths and huge stomachs that can't be satisfied. His thirst has been quenched. He has pacified his craving through tranquility, and he's liberated his mind through wisdom and insight. So this is why we combine tranquility, the calming, the steadying, the stilling of the mind with insight, the liberating of the mind through wisdom from seeing clearly. And that has the effect of quieting what literally torments us day in and day out. Now, you may not hear that in a mindfulness class. You may, if you get a good mindfulness teacher. And of course, there's obviously a trickle-down from the people who study mindfulness. There's a trickle-down into meditation classes and into retreats. So there is a cross-fertilization. But I'm still hoping that there are enough meditation teachers to teach the people who want to hear the whole thing. That's part of my message. The other is to practice with your hair on fire. And I'll give you one more sutra about practicing with your hair on fire, and then we'll call it a night. Just so you know that there is a this is a very traditionally written model. It's very masculine, but it still speaks to a stirring that each of us can have in our heart to awaken. There's something in us that's always calling us to the Spirit or calling us home, that often just gets expressed in this endless outward search. But there, we do have within us, in the midst of this craziness, we have something in us that is just invincible, that is unshakable. And if only we could just turn the other way and make that our devotion. I don't mean withdraw from the world. I mean turn your attention, your desire, your passion to awakening. Use that same power of mind that you use to get what you want. Use it to want what you get. Use it to open your heart. Use it to incline every day toward love with a sense of urgency. So this is, again, this kind of traditional model of way urgency or what's called wirya, energy of kind of passion for practice. This is a sutra from the Buddha called Unremitting Effort. Two things, O monks, I know very well. Not to be content with good states of mind, so far achieved, and to be unremitting in the practice for the goal of awakening. Unremittingly indeed did I struggle, and I resolved, let only my skin, sinews, and bones remain, let the flesh and blood in my body dry up, yet there shall be no ceasing of energy till I have attained whatever can be won by strength, energy, and effort. And effort in this case doesn't mean always physical effort. It means the effort to awaken, the effort to stay awake, to not hide away in fear and dullness. Through diligence, I have won enlightenment. Through diligence, I have won the unsurpassed security from bondage. If you too, O monks, and for the purpose of this conversation, you are all monks tonight, if you too, O monks, will practice unremittingly and resolve, let only my skin, sinews, and bones remain, let the flesh and blood in my body dry up, yet there shall be no ceasing of energy till I have attained whatever can be won by strength, energy, and effort, then you too will soon realize through your own direct perception and knowledge in this very life that unsurpassed goal of the holy life for which sons of good family rightly go forth from home into homelessness, and entering into it, you will dwell in it. Therefore, O monks, should you train yourselves thus, unremittingly shall I practice and resolve, let only my skin, sinews, bones remain, let the flesh and blood in my body dry up, yet there shall be no ceasing of energy till I have attained whatever can be won by strength, energy, and effort. Thus you should train yourself. Isn't that a strange thing to hear in this world of let me find the easy way? Let me chill. Let me check out. Let me have more. So it's, you know, where it doesn't mean renouncing all that, doesn't mean giving up all the fun that you can have in this world. But let this awakening fire be the hub around which you enjoy everything. Use everything in service of awakening. So may our practice lead to the awakening heart. May it be dedicated to the welfare and benefit of all, and may there be awakened beings who can share these, what I consider precious teachings, for the next hundreds of years, right alongside the complete proliferation of mindfulness in this world. Let it all coexist beautifully, but let's not let those who share the Dharma and make their life that their devotion, let them not have to choose between some kind of secular job and being able to be supported as Dharma teachers. And may our practice every day be dedicated to the welfare and benefit of all. And if there's been any benefit to us being together, let it be shared with the wish that every being can have happiness in their lives, that every being can be free of mental suffering, physical suffering, that every being can remain never separated from the sacred happiness that lives within us, sorrowless, here and now. And a deep wish that all beings can grow in the serenity and equanimity, the capacity to meet the inevitable joys and sorrows, gains and losses, pleasures and pain with less reactivity. May all beings be liberated. Enjoy your practice with your hair on fire. Anyway, thank you for your generosity and thanks for your presence. Hope to see you Saturday, Halloween themed half day. I'm bringing a special guest.
Where is this?